so total joy. I can't tell you what a joy it is to get up here. Sometimes it's hard for me to get away and pull away, but it just seemed like the right time. Everything about it, you guys being in a new facility, just everything was like perfect. And I wish Liz was here. I really do. We raised 7 kids, okay? And they range now from 34 to 17. And what that means is that you're really, really in this, you really planted 3 churches, okay? I planted one church called Mountain Springs Church, and now the church that I planted, the Road at Chapel Hills. But I also planted the Holt church. I mean, that's my family, right? And I remember the early days of our family that, you know, our family was bigger than church. And so that was my main service. So we had 6 grandchildren. I met my wife smuggling Bibles in China in the 80s. Her boyfriend was on the same group, and I was able to finagle her away from him. She was at UCLA, I was at the University of Georgia. So the only way we could meet is in Beijing, China, right? But we met in China, we had our first date in Hong Kong, we fell in love in LA, and we got married in Tokyo. And so our first 8 years were in Japan, we were missionaries there. And so Liz and I have been, something like 20, 30 nations of the world, doing all kinds of weird stuff. It would just take forever for me to explain all the stuff that we did. But then God called me to Fuller Theological Seminary. I went to Pasadena, California. And then met up with a guy named John Member in the Vineyard Movement, became his assistant at the Anaheim Vineyard for a few years, and then went and planted Mountain Springs Church in Colorado Springs in 94. It's a vineyard, and I left the vineyard in 2002, and then I resigned from Mountain Springs in 2014, and then I started the Road in Chapel Hills. So it's been a beautiful journey. It really has. It's been so much fun, and I've loved every part of it. I wanted to mention, though, that in this book, Worship the Warrior, A 21-Day Journey into the Dangerous Life of David, this was written about, I'm going to say, like 4 years ago. And it was, when I went through that resignation from Mountain Springs to then not knowing what God wanted me to do, it was a really, really hard time in my life, my wife and I's life. How many of you have been through times where it's hard? Maybe the present tense of your life is so grieving and so hurtful that you can't see the future. Has anybody gone through that? You will if you have. And this book was written out of that journey through the life of David. Now, this is written for men, but I get so many emails and so many comments all over the country from women who like this book. But this is really written. And the reason it's written for men is because that's why the chapters are short. So getting out of reading, I mean, seriously, man, that's like, I didn't even learn how to read until I was in 5th grade. And it's because of Mrs. Melton, and she loved me. But I'm a typical guy, and I'm a jock guy, athlete, you know. But this book is written simply, and it's about the journey of the heart, if I can think of another way to say it. It's about brokenness. It's about shame and how you break out of shame. And we started a ministry called Worship the Warrior Men's Ministry, which has really grown across the country. Just came back from a retreat. I'm getting ready to go into Atlanta, and not this week, but the next week, to do a thing with them for their men. So that's the book. It's for men. Women enjoy it. Most of the time, women buy it, read it, and then they give it to their men. Because men won't go back and get it. But there it is. So it's a good book. I think you'll like it. I had a dream last night about your church, which is really weird, because I don't have dreams. I'm going to take 2 dreams, okay? This is like a dream about your church. So I had this dream last night, and I don't sleep well when Liz is not in bed with me. So I thought, oh, so I actually brought some vitamin B PM that I do sometimes. I didn't have to do it. I was so tired. I watched the Georgia game, and we kicked Oregon's butt, so I just feel great. But I had this dream of a family that was in crisis, a husband and wife, kids, and the family, and that I was ministering to them, and I knew what to do with each one of the members of the family, and I knew when I woke up, it was for you guys, that God's called this church to be a church that will minister to families. And when I walked in, I saw a little kid. I saw more little kids in the prayer meeting than there were adults. They were like taking over the place. And by the way, just for parents, as a parent of seven kids and six grandchildren and like 100 years of parenting. In every church I pastor, we had tons of kids. But this sloping, like, floor is the worst for little kids. They're gonna face plant so many times. So when you guys first come in, make sure you're, like, holding your little hands. I saw three kids face plant. And it's because when kids are learning to walk, they kind of go like this. And then it's like times two when they come down this thing, and that's when they're going to have bloody noses in there. So try to help them along. Or have them go this way. Then it's not as bad. If they come this way, it's going to be rough. Anyway, so in the dream, I felt like that was for you guys. Which was weird because I debated, Rob and Micah debated, when I was driving, because I went right past the university. Something in us doesn't, I can't give that word because they're supposed to be here for university students. And then maybe you are. I mean, it's not one thing. It's all the systems of the Lord if you want a kingdom of God revolution. But then I felt strong and I walked in. Yeah, I just need to emphasize that. You guys, you're a young couple. A lot of young couples, a lot of singles, but you singles, listen, you'll meet the right one here.
Come on.
You will. If you think you're going to be a good-looking woman or a handsome man in a bar, you've been watching way too many commercials, man, because that is not going to happen. The best-looking women, the most handsome men are in church. We're married left and right at the road. I don't know how many weddings I've done or my staff have done over this past year with all these young 20-year-olds. My son just got married at 19, and she's 21, and that was awesome. So that's a dream for you guys. I think that's a word for you guys. I want you to meditate on it, do whatever you want with it. Maybe it's more, maybe it's not. Okay, another dream. So 3 years ago, I had this very vivid dream. Now you guys might think, and if my wife was here, she'd go, like, you never have dreams. So I'm just giving you two because they seem appropriate for this church at this time today. Remember I told you, Rob, that I rewrote a few things in the introduction. So I added this in this morning when I woke up. But in this dream, I was looking at a cityscape, and I knew it was Denver. And the buildings were dark. You may have seen modern art that often has this look. So it's kind of that image of dark buildings with kind of a light, dusty, kind of like dust sky in the background. Except there were these rolling clouds. There were rolling clouds coming in. And the Lord said to me, ominous times are coming. Now this is 3 years ago. This is 2019. Ominous times are coming. And then the Lord wrote in white letters across the building scape, 2 Chronicles 7:14. Many of you know 2 Chronicles 7:14. If my people will call by my name, humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked way, I will hear their cry. I will hear their prayer from heaven. I will come and I will heal their land and forgive their sin. So I knew something was up. I knew God was speaking about prayer for our church and the need for prayer, and I'll get into that in the message about what some of the things we've done. But since that time, I just wrote this down. This was not in my notes originally, but I want to share it here at the beginning. We've seen a plague sweep across our land over the last 2.5 years. We've seen our jobs, schools, and churches shut down. We've seen order break down with riots across our country. Cities on fire, statues torn down, George Washington, Abraham Lincoln, not by foreign enemies, but by Americans. Election, the most contentious in our nation's history. Many believe it was stolen. January 6th. This is a flood of evil in our land. We see the most anti-God, anti-child, anti-Christian, anti-moral legislation in American history. We've never seen such an assault on science, medicine, healthcare, gender, free speech, and religious freedom by our government, state and local, I mean state, local, and federal. But it's not just the government, it's a cultural shift itself. It's the elite, the big tech, big pharma, and big legacy media. The American oligarchs are working closely for the Great Reset. Does anybody know what I mean when I talk about the Great Reset? Oh, wow, okay, not many of you know about that. That's a whole nother message. You can go to the Rota Chapel House, put in the Great Reset, and see my message on that. Sometimes God has to shake us up to wake us up. So I'm an elk, deer, pheasant, you name it, hunter, fisherman, guide, fly fisherman. I do all that stuff. I'm an outdoorsman. I love it. It's the way I relax. And when we go out elk hunting, we're getting the kids up, my kids up, my tent up at like 4 a.m. And sometimes, even though they've got the little watches on and everything, I have to shake them to wake them. And then when they wake up, they have to go into 10 degrees to 20 degrees below zero weather to go hunt elk with 2-3 years ago, 20 inches of snow. So just because you get shaken up to wake up doesn't mean getting out is any easier. So that's what God's up to. So turn your Bibles to Isaiah. Look at Isaiah 59. By the way, I got a text from Heidi. So you know that Heidi's not coming, right? So Heidi, when I was running for governor, she was supposed to be here this morning. She'll be at the road on October 7th. She's been to our church several times. Heidi's great. Hope you guys get a chance to pray for her. She's not feeling well. That's all right, pray for her. So why don't I do that right now? Father, in the name of the blood of Jesus, we bless you, we praise you, we thank you, we love you. Father, we need a kingdom of God revolution in our day. We need to move your spirit across this land. We don't just need a revival, we need a revolution. And Father God, we thank you for Heidi. We thank you that she is stepping into the gap. She's willing to run for governor. She's a mom. She's a wife. And she's also got some physical ailments. So God, I pray for your healing power on Heidi right now in the name and the blood of Jesus. So look at Isaiah 59. So this is interesting because this is the passage that is the theme of the road in 2022. And it starts in the middle of 19, so we're like 19b. When the enemy comes in like a flood, and I just gave you a narrative of that. When the enemy comes in like a flood, the Spirit of the Lord will lift up a standard against him. So against the enemy, the Redeemer will come to Zion. And whenever you see Zion in the Old Testament, I always translate that to mean the church. We're the new Zion now. The Redeemer will come to Zion, and to those who turn from transgressions in Jacob, saith the Lord. Verse 21. As for me, says the Lord, this is my covenant with them, my spirit who's upon you, and my words. Now this is why this is important for you guys. Spirit, truth, Holy Spirit, Holy Bible, Word and Spirit. Spirit of Word. Here's what it says. You read it again, verse 21. This is my covenant with them, my Spirit, who is upon you, Spirit of Truth, Church, who is upon you, and my words, which I have put in your mouth, shall not depart from your mouth, nor shall the mouth of your descendants, nor from the mouth of your descendants' descendants, saith the Lord, from time and forevermore. Now let me just say this, something about this. I didn't even see this until just now. The word and spirit part is obviously the theme that this church was built on. But notice descendants, 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 that's family. That's family. So I've never seen that until just now. I think that's a great verse that God is saying, encouraging you guys with. But look at verse 60. Arise, shine, for your light is come. And the glory of the Lord has risen upon you. For behold, the darkness shall cover the earth, and deep darkness the people. But the Lord shall rise over you, and his glory will be seen upon you. The Gentiles shall come to your light, and kings to the brightness. here is righteousness, peace, and joy. Imagine a city where people celebrate life, think creatively, and dream imaginatively. Imagine a place where you would feel safe on any city street at night. Imagine a city with doctors, hospitals, and clinics that have the conviction that every life is protected and fought for, whether born or unborn. Imagine a city where there's hope in the schools because kids are excited about the future and desire to dream dreams of changing the world. Imagine a place where there's prosperity throughout every sphere of influence, whether it's media, government, healthcare, education, business, military, church, or family. People love what they do and can't wait to bring the kingdom of God into their God calling. Imagine Fort Collins being a model city to the rest of the nation. Imagine a city where the community works together on issues and problems with the goal of prosperity for all people, regardless of race, ethnicity, or socioeconomic background. Imagine Fort Collins and Larimer County starting to look a lot like Zechariah's vision. Zechariah 8.
Yes.
This is what the Lord Almighty says. Once again, men and women of ripe old age will sit in the streets of Jerusalem, each of them with cane in hand because of their age. The city streets will be filled with boys and girls playing together. Imagine Jeremiah 29. This is what the Lord Almighty, the God of Israel, says to all those that carried into exile from Jerusalem to Babylon. Build houses, settle down, plant gardens, and eat what they produce. Marry and have sons and daughters. Find wives for your sons and give your daughters in marriage, so they too may have sons and daughters. Increase in number there. Do not decrease. Also seek the peace and prosperity of the city to which I have carried you into exile. Pray to the Lord for it, because if it prospers, you also will prosper. Men and women, our vision in the church, in most cases, is way too small. We need a vision not just for ourselves and for what's happening in this church, but that God would use this church to be a part of bringing the kingdom of God to all of Fort Collins and Larimer County. My city is Colorado Springs. That's my city. I've been there 27 years. Because of the years there, I know all the county commissioners are friends of mine. They've all been to my house. And in some cases, I've been to their house. Monday, to the holiday, I've been invited to a gathering, and I think it's all the civic leaders of the city because of the guy who invited us to part of the road. We know each other. We have a relationship with each other, and we are battling for our city and for our county. Your most powerful person in this city is not your mayor, it's your sheriff, and it's your police chief. That's the most powerful two people in the county, Larimer County. You need to know them. You need to have a relationship with them. You need to be blessing them in some way, shape, or form. I don't know what their faith is, but you can bless them. I want to turn your Bibles to Matthew 4. This is where we're going to camp here this morning with the remaining time that we have. I want to talk about kingdom of God revolution, as I see it, and I think it's pretty straightforward, and what I mean by the term kingdom of God revolution. Let's start with verse 17, Matthew 4, just to give you a background. Jesus is just beginning his public ministry. The first words out of his mouth publicly, in the verses before, he deals with Satan. And in Luke, he deals also with John the Baptist. But his first public ministry is right here. And this is what he says. Really important. By the way, it's kind of a doctrine of first things. Okay, there's a doctrine of first things in the Bible. It's a doctrine of the first things even in this church. So the doctrine of first things is the idea that in the Bible, the first thing said, the first vision given, has an impact, even in the heavenly realm, far beyond what we think. So that's why it's important, men and women, and this is just kind of free. This is not really what I'm talking about. The name you give your child is important. That's kind of a first thing. That's a first statement. That's a blueprint of something. So names are important, you guys. The name of this church, who named this church is important, but what the name was that was given is important. So the first thing out of Jesus' mouth is about the kingdom of heaven. Now, kingdom of heaven, very popular term by Matthew. Luke uses kingdom of God. They're synonymous. Verse 17. From that time, Jesus began to preach and to say, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand." First message of Jesus, and the main theme of Jesus' revolutionary ministry was the kingdom of God. So, Jesus wasn't just a preacher, though he preached well. He wasn't just a reformer, though what he taught and what he believed in was reformational. He didn't come to bring a revival. He really didn't experience a revival in his 3.5 years. But he was a revolutionary. And any historian worth their salt, either from a secular historical perspective or a Christian perspective, would say Jesus was a revolutionary. He was a revolution of the kingdom of God. He spoke of the kingdom of God over 100 times. There's no other message that Jesus preached more often than the kingdom of God. He said, "Seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness." By the way, righteousness and kingdom of God always go together. We need a quick definition of righteousness. Righteousness isn't just doing the right thing. It's not just believing the right thing. Righteousness, literally, especially when you compare it with the Sermon on the Mount, which is the ethics of the kingdom of God, Matthew 5, 6, and 7, is right relationship. Now, I happen to be involved politically in a lot of things down in El Paso County. Oh my goodness, I can't believe it. I mean, seriously, man, I had never signed up. Never, ever signed up for this. And then Polis and everything that happened kind of came in and just kind of took over my life, and I couldn't stand it. I am not one to stand around and let people mess around with my people, and especially with my women. And what I mean by that is that we have widows in our church, we have divorcees in our church, we have a lot of single women in our church. We've had some creepers, man. They've come around. And if they run into me, they're in big, big trouble. Because I feel like one of my obligations as a pastor and leader is to protect my women. So I protect the most vulnerable in my church. And I believe it's my responsibility to protect the most vulnerable in our county, in our city. And I've met with my chief of police and sheriff about it. Because when all the riots were starting to occur, I didn't want that in my county. And I didn't want that in my city. And man, that we cracked down in El Paso County and ended in 2 days. Because we were not going to put up with that kind of stuff. So Jesus comes for the vulnerable. And so when he preaches of the kingdom, he says, "Seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness." So here's why that's important. That's important because the most important thing you guys do in your life is have a right relationship. That's the greatest witness of the kingdom of God, is you treat people well. We have a covenant of harmony in our church that everybody has to sign on leadership. And we've got like 45 or 50 staff now. Everybody has to sign it. And it says if there's any issues, you get crossway, you go one-on-one, you go face-to-face, you follow Matthew 18, work it out. Because everybody wants to book it, right? You want to run when relationships get hard. I'm telling you, the ways of the kingdom is righteousness, peace, and joy, and that's having right relationships. just give us about 2 weeks and we'll just mess with your life. Because we're just a bunch of people that make mistakes, but we work it out. We were just in one last Sunday. So last Sunday was a launch Sunday for us. It sounds like this is kind of your launch Sunday with your small group
churches.
With your house churches. So ours was last week, and there's games and bounce houses and food and all kinds of stuff going on. But I'm sitting in a meeting in our round table room. Remember, you guys have been, you and Beth have been in there. Dealing with a guy who's been, he's got issues, okay? Just said that. And I said, you can't do that here. We've warned you 7 times. This is it. Read the letter from the elders. You do this one more time, you're out. And I don't do this. I've been in pastor for 27 years. Missionary for 10. I don't kick people out. But you're wearing me out, man. You're wearing me thin. It's either you got to grow up before you grow old. And he got it. Now that's the reason Al's not here. It's because Al's meeting with that man. It's going to work out. We're going to restore this guy. It's going to be awesome. He's still grieving the loss of his wife. We've got to stop in his life. We have total compassion for that. But just because you have compassion doesn't mean you don't have boundaries. So, seeking the kingdom first and his righteousness, okay? Then he says, and this is something we pray a lot, I love the Lord's Prayer. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. It's God's will. He's actually challenging us to pray his prayer, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. So part of the church's responsibility, men and women, is to bring the kingdom from heaven to earth in the way we preach, the way we live, the way we act, the way we treat people. So the kingdom of God revolution is a lot of that. Kingdom of God revolution. First of all, what is the kingdom of God? Let's just say it. We live in a representative republic. Big experiment. Nobody's ever done it like we have in America. We're very, very, very close to losing it. And if we lose it, then we just go the way of the rest of history. Do you realize that freedom of speech is like really abnormal? You know, we've got a young lady here from you're from Brazil, and I don't know what kind of representative democracy or if you even have one there or not. But in most countries, and I've been all over the place, all over the world, you really don't have freedom of speech. So the censorship that you're seeing on Twitter, and the censorship that you're seeing on Instagram, and the censorship that affects, I mean, sorry if I'm offending some of you, but that part of my job description as a pastor is that I do bring offense from time to time. But I was in the hotel, I was having to look at CNN. Oh man, that was brutal. Well, a kingdom, here's what a kingdom is. A kingdom is a domain ruled by a king. It's not a representative democracy. So when we talk about the kingdom of God, we're talking about God being the king of his kingdom. That's the kingdom of God. And his ways, his rules, and his laws are enforced, guided, empowered by the king. That's the kingdom of God. So let me give you a definition of what I mean by a kingdom of God revolution. By the way, I'll give you guys a heads up here, not to be offensive any more than I already am. And that is this, that just so you know this in the future when Rob's preaching. 88% retention if you write stuff down. Okay? So everybody at the wedding has a pen and a journal. We have to actually provide a journal for them for the whole year. So if you want to remember it, you want to remember 88% of what you hear, write it down. Here's the Kingdom of God Revolution is the ongoing move of God administered through local churches who are equipping the saints. You say that again. Kingdom of God Revolution is the ongoing move of God administered through local churches who are equipping the saints, the citizens of the kingdom, to influence different cultural spheres in a local city, county, and state that brings kingdom transformation and new way of life that lasts for hundreds of years. Cultural transformation. So I guess this is my theme today, is this panel right here. So spiritual awakening, cultural transformation. Great. Who wordsmithed these things? Dude, you're like a poet. This is great. I love it. Okay, I think there's 13 cultural spheres. I want to just run through those real quick. Some say 7. I think there's 13. Number one is marriage, family, home. We have to lump all those together. Marriage, family, and home. This is the bedrock foundation of everything. So folks, everybody here, everybody repeat this. The foundation of the kingdom of God is in my marriage and in my family. So it all starts here. Don't lose that for anything out there. You're protecting, you're watching your family. Number two, church. Number two is church. And I'm going to go what I think is the order of importance. Church. Unified, praying, word-rooted, spirit-alive, culturally engaged churches. So not every church is a kingdom revolution church. Most churches are not. But if they're word-rooted, they're spirit-alive, and culturally engaged, they have the opportunity by the Spirit to use that. Number three, community. Immediate people, neighbors, and relationships God has put in your life right now at the grocery store, at the gas station. I tell my people all the time, folks, good people, go to the same stores, go to the same service stations, go to the same places, go out and eat at some of the same restaurants, because build relationships with your waiters, build relationships with the owner, build relationships with the people who you see in there, and love them, and tip them good. Anything under 20% on your tip, I kick you out of my church. These people, they work hard, they're single a lot of times, they're getting divorced, and it's hard for them. Bless them. Bless them beyond belief with your tip and be there for them. Number four, government and laws. You got to realize everything is government. So when I hear people say, I don't want to be involved in politics, man, I understand that. You know what politics means to me? Because I have investments all over the place. Politics. Their ticks, they suck all of your blood. They take all your money. That's what I think about it. I don't like it, but it's a reality. It's everything. When you walk out of this place and you cross the street, there's lines in the street, that's because of politics. You turn right at a red light. You stop at a red light. You slow down or maybe you speed up at a yellow light. You go forward and know everything. Everything. Everything is politics. The fact that we have this building right now is political. We need to elect men and women who passionately love America, the Declaration of Independence, the Bill of Rights, and our Constitution. Number five, food and agriculture. Food and agriculture. You can't live a healthy life if you're eating crummy food, okay? We need to get back to small farms, farmers markets, healthy production of food, and healthy choices. Listen, we have 7 children, I told you that, and they grew up on elk and deer and pheasant, and I mean, we were talk about grass-fed, right? Okay? Some of them sage-fed. I shot a deer last year way up in the northwestern part of the state, and I knew as soon as I shot it, this is going to be some crummy meat, man. Because they eat that sage and stuff. So I mixed it with, we were watching the Georgia game yesterday, and I mixed the deer with some grass-fed beef, so it was okay. But guys, this is important. I don't have time to go into it. We talk a lot about it at the road. And that is that you got to eat healthy. Folks, if anything has woken us up to the importance of this, it was COVID. The people who are the most susceptible to getting COVID were, generally speaking, not every time, but generally speaking, unhealthy people. You've got to build and strengthen your immune system. Number six, business and entrepreneurship. We need entirely new businesses. We need small businesses in our city and in our county. I would love to see, at least in Colorado Springs, over the next few years, just hundreds of new small businesses popping up by local people. So we're talking about this. I'm going to say to you guys, nobody's going to listen to this message anyway in the road because they'll be doing this, they're too busy with things, but you can quote me later on that. But that is, I'm going to announce to our church in a couple of weeks that we're going to take two local businesses a month and we're going to emphasize them at the road. So we're going to emphasize, go to these stores. Go to these places. These were started by Colorado Springs people, and we want to bless them. We want to see them flourish. We want to see them take off in our area, you know. When you're doing construction, go with a local construction company. You want to go to a plumber, a local plumber. Forget these guys that are out there with their big stores and stuff. I mean, I'm God's for them too. God loves them. They're doing fine. But I would rather raise up a new breed of leader that are entrepreneurial, just like you guys are. Keep it up. It's fantastic. So 5 out of 7 of my kids have started their own businesses. So my son, 19, started his business at 15. And if you want some great videos and videography, check out Josh's stuff. You can just go to the road and find it there. He does all our videography there, but he has his own business on the side that he's flourishing in and at. Number 7. Media, freedom of speech and press. Media is an important area. And I'm so excited over the last 2 years how many new podcasts are popping up. I mean, my son's in law school at UNLV, and he'll come back and say, what's your latest, greatest podcast? And he's got this list of people I've never heard of. They're all 20-somethings, and they're more radical than anybody my age. And by the way, I'm going to say this aside like this. And this is really true statistically. People who watch CNN are about 55 and above. I mean, that is a dying breed. That's the reason that whole 300,000 or 400,000 watching them. You know, you got Tucker Carlson, he's got 3.5 million every newscast. You've got Ben Shapiro, you've got so many like that, there are millions. I even like Joe Rogan for some of these. He's a little bit crass, but got some good stuff from time to time. He loves freedom, I'll say that. Number 8 is education. School boards, teachers. Do we have any teachers in here? Teachers. God bless you guys. Homeschoolers. We homeschool our kids. Like, we homeschool charter school, private schools, and public school. And for various reasons we did that because each one was different. But education. Number 9, healthcare, medical. More on this later. 10, finance and banking. Number 11, first responders. Police, sheriff, fire, EMTs. We have any first responders in here? Okay. Military is number 12, and 13 is the marks. Okay, here's what I want to do. I want to talk about the person, the pattern, and the power. And if I'm going to, what time do y'all usually end? Because then you guys can just leave when you want to. Huh? Okay, when I'm done. That'll be when it's done. No, I'm serious. If you need to leave, I tell people all the time, if it's one of those sermons where I'm going to go, fine. You know, do what you need to do. But look at back, we're still at Matthew 4, look at 17 through 19. From that time, Jesus began to preach and say, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. And Jesus, walking by the Sea of Galilee, saw two brothers, Simon called Peter, and Andrew his brother, casting a net into the sea, for they were fishermen. Verse 19. Then he said to them, follow me. Number 1, the person of the kingdom. Jesus said, follow me. You can't have a kingdom of God without a God. And you can't have a God without Jesus. And Jesus is the key to everything. It all starts here. It all continues here. It all ends here. Everything's about Jesus. Don't get off, away, or distant from Jesus. Jesus is where it's at. If you're here today and you're on a personal Bible dynamic, growing relationship with Jesus Christ, you ought to do that. If you're smart, you should get a new jersey. Instead of self, you should have Jesus on your jersey, okay? He'll make you courageous. He'll make you bold. He'll make you loving. He'll set you free. And so it all started there for me when I was 18. I was at the University of Georgia, and I was an athlete there. I injured my left knee, and I was bummed out. Cute gal came into the training room, wasn't supposed to be there, She invited me to this meeting with Campus Crusade. She was so cute. I thought we got more of those there. So I went. That's about how deep spiritual I was at the time. And I won't go through the whole story, but gave my heart to Christ a few months ago. Now, I grew up religious. So my dad was a Lutheran pastor. I was baptized at 6 weeks old in a dress. I mean, if you think about wearing a dress in your baptism, I'm so glad I went out to that particular denomination. But for 18 years, that's all I knew, and I was confirmed at 16. I was full of religion, but I had no relationship with Jesus. And through this group of fired-up Christians at University of Georgia, I got fired up because of them, and I discovered the life, death, and resurrection of Christ for my life. And I discovered this, that in Genesis 1, we have a picture of the authority that was ours at one time. The kingdom of God. Genesis 1. And God said, let us make man in our image, according to our likeness. Let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the birds of the air, and over the cattle, and over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creeps on the earth. So God created man. It is own image. In the image of God, he created him male and
female.
What an awful thought. Did y'all see the movie, What Is a Woman?
Yeah.
So he's asking this psychotherapist, a PhD, what is a woman? He goes, well, I'm not a woman, so I can't answer that. So he goes, well, what is a cat? And everybody knows what a cat is. Oh, I'm a cat. Seriously, man, we're talking about brain dead. God created them, male and female. Can you believe we're even having this dystopian discussion right now? Then he said, God blessed them, and he said to them, be fruitful and multiply, fill the earth, subdue it, have dominion over the fish of the sea, and it goes on. Men and women were created to have dominion. We're supposed to have dominion over the earth. That dominion was lost when the first Adam sinned. So the second Adam came, which is Jesus, to restore dominion through you. You have dominion. That's why it's important. When you look at you guys, you know, you young guys out here, young women out there, I don't know if you know. You know what your future is or what God's got for you, but God has placed his dominion power, his dominion authority in your heart. You're created in the image of God. God gave that to you for you to focus outward with your life to make an impact on the earth. So when Jesus came to do that, he said, this is the way it'll look. It'll look like righteousness, peace, and joy. So it won't be eating and drinking, Romans 14:17. It'll be righteousness, peace, and joy. So what that means is it'll come from your heart, church. It's going to come from. So the kingdom revolution begins with experiencing Christ here. Then it spills out. It pours forth through the Spirit in your life. He says, first of all, repent. Metanoia is the Greek. It means to turn around. It means to do a 180. Turn from your ways to his ways. And in so doing, the kingdom revolution begins in your life. So me, it was at 18, I had a kingdom revolution. Now, in a local church, it's a community of saints that are experiencing that kingdom of God revolution. Now, I don't know you guys very well, but I would imagine a group this size, there's some of you here that have never fully, completely surrendered to Christ. You're here because someone invited you. We're so glad you're here. But I want to challenge you that Jesus loves you and he has a wonderful, awesome, incredible plan for your life. And when he comes in, he sets you up for lining yourself and your heart up with the most important thing, and that's the kingdom of God in your life. That's what you were born for, and that's what you long for. His presence, his power, and his passion in your So it begins with the kingdom. And I think this is why, at least for us, and then for, I know for Rob and Mike, and this was true, you guys know each other, well, you've known each other since high school. But when Holmes said, and it was federal too, it was all over the country, shut down your churches, I drank the Kool-Aid for about 4 weeks. And then I've got a Cracker Jack research team at the road. I said, research COVID-19. Research it. So I had people researching, probably about 20 people on it. We came together. We put all our resources together. We realized it's not what they're saying it is. This dog doesn't hunt. We use a southern term. And so I decided we're opening up. We're going to open up our church. So I called a meeting of pastors, 87 pastors in Colorado Springs came. We're all in the sanctuary. And I said, you guys, we're opening up on, I think it was the first week of May. So I think we were closed just April. That's all we were closed. And here's why. I'll give you 3 or 4 reasons. You guys do whatever you want. It's your church. It's your decision. But this is why we're doing it. Well, 20, and I'm thinking, okay, Holmes is going to send me to prison. I would love to have some other people here. So 25 churches agreed, they came forward, and like a month later, 25 more, probably a month later, like 25 more, and I knew, oh, this is in trouble, man, you can't do anything about it. It was like 75 or 80 churches just in El Paso County that are opening up. And then I get this call from this guy named Sean Floyd, and I said, no, I call Sean Floyd. Yeah. And I said, hey, man, let's do something in Colorado, because I've heard about it. I didn't know Sean from Adams Bellarmine. I didn't know that. And we started talking, well, there's this other guy. He's up in Fort Collins, and he wants me to come there. And I said, who is he? He said, Rob Ray. And I said, okay, so then I called you. And I said, let's do it back to back. So on 9-11, 2020, Rob does his thing up here at your park. I came up to it, really fun, visited with us, we came along. And then we drove down to 912, we did it in Memorial Park. The police told us, you can't do this, it's illegal, you could get arrested. I said, fine, that sounds great, I need that on my resume, I've got everything else, I'm not going to get an arrest on my resume. So we did it, 6,000, you probably had about 3,000 or 4,000, right? Yeah, we had 6,000. Did you come down to pray? Yeah, so Rob came. And we did that, and dude, I mean, we were off the money, man. And I realized that the people wanted leadership. And you were providing it up here. Praise God, we were providing it down there. 27 pastors got behind it. This is crazy. So Antifa is on the rise in Colorado Springs because the riots have been happening, you know, that summer. So that's what everybody was concerned about, was Antifa this, Antifa that. And I know the leaders of Antifa. And I'm like, hey man, I'm not real smart, I'm from Georgia, but I figured it out. Like, I could take on Antifa without anybody, okay? So we had some special forces guys, a friend of mine, they came in, they flew in from around the country to ring the place with security. And then the police came, the sheriff's department came, and the sheriff, not his undersheriff, but the head sheriff said to me, he said, that's the best security we've ever had in Colorado Springs. I mean, the crowds infiltrated. By the way, man, if you ever see a guy hanging out of your church and he's kind of looks a little disheveled and has a beard, but you see a bulge back here, right there, and he actually looks like he's pretty smart, he might be an undercover agent, okay? And I've had a ton of those in my church. So they frequent my church from time to time. I've gotten so many death threats over the last 2 years. We had one 3 days ago from a conservative. That's crazy, man. It's pretty fun, though. So then we did an op-ed. This is something y'all might consider. But when they were doing it with all the shutdowns, I got 27 pastors and we did an op-ed in the Gazette, basically to poll us to open up our county. And then we did a declaration with the county commissioners. So this is pretty fun. This is really fun, actually. We did the county commissioners. You guys, why don't you guys make a declaration, like a declaration of independence? like a declaration of liberty to hold us and say, we're not gonna enforce any of your shot mandates, we're not gonna enforce it, and we're gonna encourage people to actually open up their stores if they want to. Now, you guys understand, some people, it's the right thing for them to stay shut, I'm not saying everybody's, I'm just saying the mandate that you have to be shut was the issue. So they wrote this declaration, they came to the road, they gave it. We got 8 standing ovations at that service, and then we did it down at Centennial Hall, 11 standing ovations at that, as they gave 350 plus people came, the largest ever county commissioner board meeting. It was really cool. But it helped unite the county, you hear what I'm saying? It helped unite the city. It doesn't take much, it just takes strategic people. Number 2, verse 19. Then he said to them, follow me and I'll make you fishers of men. They immediately left their nets and followed him. Going on from there, he saw 2 other brothers, James, the son of Zebedee, John, his brother, and both with Zebedee, their father, mending their nets. He called them. And immediately they left the boat and their father and followed him. Number 2, the pattern of the kingdom is discipleship. The pattern of the kingdom is discipleship. Men and women, the pattern of the kingdom is empowering the leader. Not just Jesus' followers, but leaders. We got to raise up leaders, and especially among our young people. These 12 men, we don't know their age, but some would say somewhere in their 20s and 30s, probably, changed the world. They changed the world. We're here today because of 11 of the 12 who died martyrs' deaths because they were leaders proclaiming the kingdom. Ephesians 4 says, and he himself gave some to be apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, some pastors and teachers, for the equipping of the saints, for the work of ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ. Matthew 28:18, Jesus said, all authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. Go, therefore, make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, teaching them, what we're doing today, to observe all things that I've commanded you, and lo, I'm with you always. It's a heart set. It's a mindset. That's what your house churches are for. That's what the gathering is for. This is about equipping the saints. Nobody's going to equip leaders like the church can. Certainly not going to happen in our school system. Not going to happen in our universe. It has to happen in the church. We have to be raising up leaders. You parents, raise up leaders. Your first school, your first academy are those kids that are under your care from God, even at a very little age. Start pouring into them, putting security in them by loving them, and breaking the power of the natural tendency. Building wholehearted disciples. Revolutionary leaders. So, okay. I can see this look like, what are you going to say? So, when COVID came, like I already said, we opened up our church. But I wasn't convinced that what they were telling us medically was true, or number 2, that the shot was the key. So again, we got the team together, we did the research, and we developed our own COVID protocol. We call it Radical Resiliency Ministry. We healed 3,000 people in El Paso County, not one person died. So if you took, and you can hear it, it's available now, if you have Radical Resiliency, we're still sending them out, probably a dozen or 2 dozen a week. But the Radical Resiliency Protocol, filled with vitamins and zinc, and ivermectin and stuff like that, we went against the narrative. 3,000 people took it. If you took it within 5 days, you'd be well within 5 days. Out of 3,000, 8,000 nationwide. So half of your congressmen in Denver contacted us. I mean, I couldn't believe how many were contacting us, and we healed them. So when we talk about signs and wonders and laying hands on the sick, and I believe in all that, and I'm 100 of you, we pray for people every week for healing. This was healing using God's ingredients. God's already given us his ingredients for healing. I tell people all the time, listen, if you're going to go, and I'm going to pray for your diabetes today, and then you're going to go out to McDonald's 3 or 4 times this week, I'm sorry. Don't put that on me, man. You're just looking. I mean, you're seeking first diabetes and all the sickness thereof. So the radical resilience and ministry took off, and we saw so many people healed. Then we started Church Voter Guide. Church Voter Guide, you guys are all too young. But back when I was younger, when I was your age, Focus on the Family had a church voter guide about elections and stuff. Well, they don't have that anymore, so we decided to start around, and now it's gone nationwide. And in El Paso County, 45% increase in voting because of church voter guides. Totally nonpartisan. It's really good. Look up church voter guides, plural, churchvoterguides.org.com, and you'll see it. And we ask questions. You have 150 word answers from each candidate. Doesn't matter what the party is. Doesn't matter what the persuasion is. You can see exactly what people believe. So we did El Paso County, 45% increase in voting, and we turned 5 out of 6 school boards over from left to right. Just by voting. So I don't know what's happening up here, but the kind of crap, sorry to use a biblical term, the kind of crap that you're seeing in your schools, it's being allowed in the schools, not happening in El Paso County. And it's because we turned the school board, we turned all those school board members. And the others didn't turn over because they were already conservative. It worked! Folks, it's a representative democracy. You sit by, the enemy's going to take over. They're always looking for that opportunity. Now, let me say this about children's ministry. One thing that we're doing now, and I don't know, you got so many little kids, so this is probably not appropriate yet, but we started doing stuff on babies. So we've got a whole study from Genesis that my wife developed, and that's Church Looks Great News down there, which shows the development of the baby, and we're doing it to be a direct assault on abortion, but training kids in DNA and how they're created is really, really exciting. We did a conference, got another one coming up on a pro-life conference called Created in His Image, and that's what we do. We've done it once last year, we did it once this year. And then we're doing one on holy sexuality in February. We're calling it Holy Sexuality. Anybody heard of Dr. Christopher Youth? The movie. Okay. So this one's on marriage, singleness, and same-sex attraction. That's what the conference is going to be about. Marriage, singleness, and same-sex attraction. It's going to be really, really good. Dr. Ewan, oh my goodness, his story is unbelievable. This guy, he was 1 month away from graduating from dental school, gets busted for drugs, and he's a huge drug dealer, and goes down to Atlanta and becomes this major drug dealer for 13 states down there. Totally into the gay lifestyle and everything. 10 federal agents knocking at the door, opens the door, 10 years in prison. He's in prison, he's walking through the courtyard of the prison, he looks over at this trash bin, piled up with trash, and all he can say is, that's me. That's who I am. And then sitting on top, he saw this little green thing. So he goes over and takes this green thing off, and it's a Gideon New Testament Bible, and he reads the whole thing in 1 week. He gets radically saved. He goes to seminary, becomes a PhD, now he lectures all over the place about holy sexuality. It's really, really good. Look him up, listen to him. He's awesome. That's a conference coming up in February. All right, lastly, and I'll let you guys get going here. Verse 23. And Jesus went about all Galilee, teaching in their synagogues, preaching the gospel of the kingdom, and healing all kinds of sicknesses and all kinds of diseases among the people. But his fame went throughout all Syria, and they brought in all the sick people who were afflicted, various diseases and torments, and those who were demon-possessed, epileptics and paralytics, and he healed them. Number 3, the power of the kingdom. The power of the kingdom. You realize that the disciples were with Jesus for 3.5 years? 24/7? I mean, they're with him all the time. And he said, you're not ready to do anything. Don't go. Don't do anything I've been doing. You'll mess it up. You have no idea how to do kingdom work. When you think after 3.5 years, you might know a few things. I mean, they were standing there when he cast out demons. They're standing there when they know exactly the wording to use. They know how to, you know. You know? And they're like, wow, Jesus doesn't even wear white shoes like many men. You know? And so they, you know, he says, you're not ready. Until you're endued with power. You have to have the power of the Holy Spirit. It's not techniques. It's not structure. It's the power of God. It's the fire of God within you. And so, you know, in Acts 1, he tells them that. In Acts 2, they get blasted by the Holy Spirit. By Acts 17:6, the Thessalonians, this is what they say. Those men who have upset the world have come here also. Or those men who have turned the world right side up have come here also. That's what the church is supposed to do. That's kingdom ministry. God wants to use you guys here to rock this city and to rock this county for Jesus. But you have to be filled with the Holy Spirit. And if you are, hello, it's a word and deed transaction. It's not just, see, this is illumination. Illumination comes from the word. But what people are longing for is an illustration of the word. And the illustration of the word is spirit-filled believers, spirit-filled leaders who come to change people's lives. People in Larimer County need an illustration of the kingdom of God this year. May we ask him for that. May we ask him for that. So then it concludes with this. Great multitudes followed him from Galilee, Decapolis, Jerusalem, Judea, and beyond the Jordan. Let me just conclude with this. With the presence of Jesus, the pattern of Jesus, and the power of Jesus, God desires to bring a kingdom revolution in our city, state, and nation. I'm going to say three things. The first one I'm going to say is the power of prayer. So we started noonday prayer 715 days ago, Monday through Friday. Been going for 715 straight days, noonday prayer. Here's what I found. Most people can't pray more than 1 hour. And that's because Steve Holt can't pray much more than 1 hour. So you guys, they can go into a prayer room and pray for hours, and I just think that's awesome. It's just not me. My mind starts to wander. So we do noon to one, Monday through Friday. And sometimes there's 3 people, and sometimes there's 33 people. But we pray, we seek answered prayer. And we're very specific about what we're praying for. We pray exactly the things, and I don't have time to go into all of the details of that. We had a National Day of Prayer at our church last year. 27 pastors and 19 civic leaders came. And it was anointing, man. 800 were there. We were packed in this room, praying for our country, praying for our city. All the county commissioners were there. It was awesome. You can do that here. And then here's the second. Power of men. The power of men. And I love women. I'm married to women. I think women are awesome. And you guys are way more spiritual than us. You're much more godly than all of us. You're much more relational. You're very people. I'm being totally serious. Women are the backbone of our country. But God has a special anointing on men too. And I've made it part of my goal, I've made it part of my vision to raise up powerful men. So a couple years ago, we started a breakfast at 6 a.m. on Tuesday morning called Wholehearted Men. employer. You do a killer breakfast. Best breakfast in Colorado Springs. I said, listen, we're going to do a breakfast. You can't go on any cheesy church breakfasts. You know, like church breakfasts are like biscuits and gravy. No, we've got smoked meats in the whole nine yards. And it's grown to over 400 men. Every 400 men come, every Tuesday, 400 men come together. And they're fired up. We have tables where the guys meet. They come in there and they pray. And I heard y'all just started. That's how it started. We started with 10 guys, and then we grew it from there. And we didn't have a breakfast at first. That was something that came later when we had a lot of people. But there's something about men empowered by the Spirit. I pray that for you guys. I pray a kingdom of God revolution here in your city and county through this church. So can I pray for you?
Yes,
thank you, guys. It's 11:30. You guys are still here. I wanted to say my hats off to you. God bless you to hear. Listen to me for all this time.
So,
what'd you say?
We're a long way.
Okay. So, Father, in the name of God, Jesus, I bless the people you bless right here today, and I thank you for them. I pray, Lord, that this church will be mightily used from the Word, in the Spirit, for our families, all over Laramie County. And I pray, Holy Spirit, that you would move in such a way that it would be obvious that this church could not have done what you called it to do except through an endowment of the Holy Spirit. In your name we pray. Amen. God bless you.
Thank you, Pastor Steve. We're going to do some ministry time.